going on? Mm-hmm.
Good morning. I see now what you're saying about bread.
Yeah,
I see. I'm sorry.
It's very distracting.
Yes. Glad to see everybody out today. Ernie isn't here today. And Billy couldn't make it today. And Gerard showed up and was going to play little drums and stuff. And I said, Ernie won't be here. And he said, well, I can do that. Really? So, he can do that. So I asked him when he's done practicing, I said, what else can you do? Hey, you're holding out on us. So Gerard's been holding out on us. So I'm glad to have him here with us today. I'm glad he could fill in. We're just going to worship today in spirit and truth. That's what it's all about. Maybe Gerard can teach Gordon something to play so that he can, maybe help us.
He can play second fiddle.
Second fiddle. Yeah. Okay. We'll get a chair for him. He'll play second fiddle. Let's stand. Let's open the word of prayer. Let's just give God a prayer. Father, I thank you so much for just allowing us to be here today. Father, just to worship you in spirit and truth. Father, as we do that today, just bless our voices, bless our talents. Let us give you honor, glory, and praise because you're worthy. Father, just let your spirit move among us today. We love you. We thank you for everything you've done for us. You're an awesome God. And Father, we pray 2021 will be a great year. Father, hopefully we can tell other people about you this year. We love you. We thank you for everything. You're an awesome God. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh,
mountains I can climb. I will lift my eyes to the thank you.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for allowing everyone here to gather here and learn more about you and learn how to be better within you, God, and to follow within your words and your footsteps. Father, as we come here today, as Evan brings you forth your message, we pray that we take whatever this message is, we take it into our everyday life and we just we worship more about you, God.
God, we thank you so much for giving us a new year as we have started. This is our first gathering in your name in this day. We know how things have been, and your eyes were open. We saw how everything was. Things were bad, bad in shape. However, Father, we count on you. I am saying this first service of the year, we celebrate your name. We ask you, Father, to be with us, especially be with them as he brings us your message. Bring us your spirit for understanding and also for
job there, drummer. It's pretty good. He's going to sing free solos next week, so just be good for that. Free solos, you going to sing free solos next week? Mansion Over the Hilltop time, Gordon. Get that going. I do want you to please be in prayer for Becky. She tested positive for the virus about a week or so ago, so she's out of commission, feeling better. But she was not feeling well there for a while, so just please continue to keep her in your prayers. We are 48 hours into this new year of 2021, and I think we're all hoping that this year would be better than last year. And a whole lot of things have changed from January 2020 to January of 2021. But one thing that hasn't changed is the propensity of people to take this time of year to talk about and to establish New Year's resolutions. And specific resolutions can look different from person to person, but generally, New Year's resolutions tend to fall in kind of the same general categories. The following five from what I recently read. First is health and weight type of resolutions. You want to lose weight, you want to get in better shape. Two is money type resolutions. People want to spend less, get more discipline, maybe get out of debt. Thirdly, is a little more specific, is just to quit smoking. Fourthly, is to just get more organized in your personal life. And then number five has to do with family type of New Year's resolutions. People want to spend more time with family, grow closer to their family, and those types of things. Basically, when you look at New Year's resolutions and you trace them to their root, you look at the foundation, at the core of New Year's resolutions, they are all about habits. New Year's resolutions are about habits. They're about breaking bad habits or forming new habits. They're about both sometimes. Because the thing is, we all have habits, every single one of us. We are all creatures of habit. And that's the title of this message series that I'm starting today that's going to encompass the entire month of January. Whether you want to be or not, whether you want to acknowledge it or not, all of us are creatures of habit to some extent. We are all creatures of habit. We tend to have certain routines or tendencies that we repeat on a seemingly regular basis. Now, if you doubt that you are a creature of habit this morning, let me just ask you a quick question. Where are you sitting right now? And where were you sitting last week? If you weren't here last week, where were you sitting 2 weeks ago? Because before you entered this room today, I could pretty well guess where about 75% of you were going to be sitting today before you even walked into this room, because we tend to sit in the same spots. You probably parked in the same place you usually park. If somebody's sitting in your spot, it just throws everything out of kilter for you, and you have to watch out. And when it comes to habits, as you know, there are both positive habits and there are negative habits that we all have. And every habit that is on display in our lives is there, it's been placed there because of regular reinforcement. And so in this study, our goal is to take these habits and to redirect them in such a way that it will lead to spiritual growth and that it will lead to us becoming more like Jesus. And in studying this series, I came across some material. I've been reading a lot about habits here in the last week or so, but I came across some material by Craig Rochelle that has really helped me. But he has a quote that he has used, he said, for years, that helps to explain why habits are so important. And this is the quote that he often says. He says that successful people do consistently what most people do occasionally. Say that again. Successful people do consistently what other people do occasionally. Not getting anything up there? Did you start it over? Okay, start it over. Reboot it, Curtis. Don't reboot the machine. Just go out of the program and start it back up. Successful people do consistently what other people do occasionally. In any area of life where a person has achieved some semblance of success, and what I mean by that is that they have achieved something on their own. They have succeeded on their own. It's because they have done things consistently that other people have only done occasionally. Now, a lot of you who are UK basketball fans, you, like me, watched the basketball game last night. It's been a really, really lousy UK basketball season so far. We were all giddy last night when the hometown boy, Dante Allen, he got his chance, hit 7 threes, scored 23 points, helped Kentucky to win a very important game, the first SEC conference game. And he has not played much this year, but the one thing you know about Dante, if you know Dante Allen at all, and he said this in a lot of his post-game interviews, people asked, how did you do this, and what's been your mindset as you struggled to get off the bench, and those kinds of things. And his answer was pretty much consistent. I watched his post-game press conference last night, and he had answered about a half dozen questions, and they were mostly related to, I just continue to work. I just continue to put in my work, put in my work, put in my work. In fact, last night he was interviewed after the game by the SEC Network, and the announcer asked him a question along the lines of, when you get back to Lexington tonight, you're from Pendleton County, a very close drive to Lexington. He said, you're going to be flying high. He said, you're going to be walking on air. What are you going to do when you get home tonight to Lexington? And he said, be honest, if I have time, I'm going to go get a workout. And people that know that kid know that he is a, what they call a gym rat. And you see him all the time. He's shooting basketball. He comes up here a lot during the summer, and he'll shoot for 2, 4, 6 hours every single day. Now, people see 23 points. People see him signing autographs. They don't see every single day shooting 1,000, 1,200, 1,500 shots every single day. Successful people do consistently what other people do occasionally. And so if you look at somebody and you can see that maybe they have achieved financial success on their own. What I mean by that is they didn't win the lottery, they didn't inherit a bunch of money, because that's not financial success. That's random chance or somebody succeeding for them. But you find somebody who's achieved financial success on their own, it's because they consistently did things that other people only do occasionally, if ever. So they consistently gave generously. And they consistently spend less than they make. They consistently keep debt at a minimum or no debt at all. They consistently save. They consistently invest. They succeeded because they consistently did things that most other people only do occasionally. If you have a person who's in great personal health or fitness, they're in great shape. They don't have a submarine for a belly like I do. They don't start wheezing when they climb a set of steps. They achieve that personal success by consistently doing what other people only do occasionally. They consistently eat right. They consistently exercise. They consistently count calories. They don't look for some fad diet. They don't look for this gimmick of 1 month of cleansing or whatever. They have consistently done things that most people only do occasionally. If you have someone in your life that you see that they are spiritually strong, they seem to have a relationship with the Lord that is deep and it's rich and it's intimate, there is a reason that they have that. It's because they consistently do things that most other people only do occasionally. They're consistently reading Scripture. They're consistently talking to the Lord in prayer, consistently confessing, consistently fasting, consistently giving, consistently serving, consistently living by the Spirit. They're doing these things consistently, and not just occasionally. And look, you can see this truth all over the pages of Scripture. And so I think most people, for example, would consider Jesus to be a very strong person, a very successful person in his faith during his 33 years on this planet. Here's one of the big reasons why. You know, there's one thing you never, ever, ever heard Jesus say. Never. Not ever did you ever hear Jesus say, I just don't have the time. I just don't have the time to pray. I just don't have the time for quiet time. I'm so busy. These disciples, Peter's wearing me out. He gets on my last nerve. I give up. I wish I had more time to spend with the Father, but I just don't have that kind of time right now. Maybe later. Jesus never, ever, ever said anything like that. What Jesus did do is you see him consistently break away from the crowds to go have intimate time with God the Father. He'd go off to a mountainside by himself to pray. He would withdraw, Scripture says, to lonely places, spending that time with God the Father, so that his relationship with the Father remained strong. He consistently did things that other people only do occasionally. Sean Covey put it this way, He said, our habits make or break us. We become what we repeatedly do. And that is the truth. You become what you repeatedly do. You're good at what you repeatedly do. And so, the reason you're good at knowing what's going on in everybody else's lives, and your knowledge of Scripture is sketchy at best, is because the hours you spend on Facebook compared to the hours you spend in God's Word is embarrassing. Facebook is your habit, and you're an expert at it. Congratulations. Why do I sometimes feel like I lack wisdom when I'm making decisions, whether it's for the church, whether it's for my family, whether it's for me personally? Why do I sometimes feel like I lack wisdom? Because I think that a lot. It's because I don't spend nearly enough time in prayer. It's because I spend oftentimes more time reading books about God's Word than I do reading God's Word. That might help explain why wisdom. Why do you still struggle with your temper after all these years? Why has your addiction to pornography gotten worse and worse? Why do you still secretly enjoy the attention of men who are not your husband? Why do you consistently find time to criticize and to find fault? It's because we continue to feed those things on a daily basis. Why do you consistently follow the preacher around on Sunday mornings? Because that's just what you do. Can you go back to your mom and dad? Our habits make or break us, right? Our habits, we become what we repeatedly do, what we consistently do. The reason we have these struggles is because we continue to feed these habits. Our habits make or break us. We become what we repeatedly do. Now you see this in Scripture as well. You see this specifically with the Apostle Paul. He asks some of these very same questions that we are asking today. In Romans chapter 7, look at what Paul says in verses 18 and 19. He says, I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. Notice what he says here. I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. He says, what I do is not the good that I want to do. No, the evil that I don't want to do. He said, that's what I keep on doing. I don't know about you, but I can identify with that. We might say it like this. I want to stop eating so much junk food. I want to stop procrastinating. I want to stop spending so much money at Kohl's. I want to get closer to the Lord. I want to do what's good, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. I do what I don't want to do. And that's how Paul feels. And so he kind of makes he kind of does what a lot of us tend to do in these situations. He connects his failures to his identity as a person. And so he says in verse 24, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? Paul says, who's going to free me from consistently doing wrong things? Who's going to free me from this life that is predominantly dominated by sin? Now, thankfully, he looks at the source. He looks to the source who can truly change him. And he says in verse 25, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus is the one who can change us. He is the one who can strengthen us to consistently do things that most people only occasionally do. He is the one who can make us new. The Bible says that in Christ the old is gone and the new has come. It's in Christ that the old is gone and the new has come. And so it's my prayer and it's my hope that through the power of Christ, we will be able to experience all of the life that's available to us. That we would live out these disciplines that we're going to talk about for the next 4 weeks in this series. And the hope is that these disciplines will lead to a God-honoring, God-pleasing, successful life for His kingdom. Because successful people do consistently what other people do occasionally. Successful people don't make New Year's resolutions. Successful people consistently practice certain spiritual disciplines that most people only occasionally do. Now, most of us would say we want this. Most of us would agree with everything that's been said this morning. Most of us would say we want to be creatures of habit in a good way that helps us become more like Jesus. I don't know if anybody here would reject that goal for life. We have good intentions, but we so often don't follow through. And the question is, why is that? Why are these good habits, why are these spiritual disciplines that we're going to talk about in this study, why are they so difficult to develop and maintain? Well, the time we have left, I want to show you three of what I believe to be the primary reasons why we struggle to succeed in creating these good habits. The first reason is this. We focus on the what, but we don't understand the how. A lot of the times, the reason we fail at this is we focus on the what, but we don't understand the how. We focus our attention on the action that we want to perform, the habit we want to develop. In other words, we don't understand how to get there, but we know where we want to be. Think about it. Most of us have goals that we talked about at the beginning. We have goals that are in similar categories. Most of us, for example, would say that we want to have good health, right? Most of us would say, I want to have good health. I don't know a lot of people who, if you ask them, would say, you know, my goal in 2020 is to develop dangerously high cholesterol. I don't think anybody would say that. When it comes to finances, people don't say, let me tell you what my goal is for 2021. It's to double the debt that we currently have, and to get that debt at high interest rates, say 19 or 20% would be fantastic. And if we could be on the verge of bankruptcy by Christmas of 2021, that would be fantastic. Nobody says things like that. You don't hear a coach at the beginning of basketball season trying to motivate his or her team by saying, we're going to get in here and practice every day, play as hard as we can. We want to improve as the season progresses because we're shooting for a sixth place finish. They don't say that. When somebody gets married, they don't say, well, we hope to have a really strong marriage for 5 or 6 years, but then divorce is in the works after that, if that's what it comes to. We all want to be successful. And we all, whether we're successful or unsuccessful, we all want to achieve similar goals. But we don't do that. It's because goals don't determine success. Goals do not determine success. They're good, but they don't determine success. What determines success are the systems that you put in place to reach those goals. Goals do not form success. The systems you put in place to accomplish those goals bring about success. Let me give you a good example of this from the pages of Scripture. In the Old Testament, there's this guy, very faithful man by the name of Daniel. If you want to model your life after somebody who really stood out and had great faith, Daniel is a tremendous case study. Because here's the thing about Daniel. He lives the majority of his life in a foreign land, in a place that does not worship the same God as he. But he always seems to stand out among his peers. And no matter where he was planted in that foreign country, Daniel always bloomed. He always thrived. And the reason for that is because he had systems put in place to help him reach the goal of faithfulness. Now, what systems did he have put in place? We find those systems in the famous story of Daniel and the lions. Daniel had lived a significant chunk of his life in the nation of Babylon. And even though that's a foreign land who doesn't worship the same God that Daniel does, he thrives anyway. And Daniel becomes a very high-ranking official in the Babylonian government. He's an Israelite. He's one of the captives. But he's a high-ranking government official in the Babylonian government. Well, later in his life, the Babylonians are overthrown, and there's a new king in town by the name of Darius the Mede. And Darius is now organizing his government, and as he's looking for people to appoint to certain positions, Daniel stands out among the rest. Daniel had been in power in Babylon, and even though the Babylonians had been overthrown by Darius the Mede, Daniel still impresses the king. So Darius is about to make the decision to put Daniel over the entire Medo-Persian kingdom. And that does not sit well with some of the politicians of that day. So here's what they do. They begin to conduct this smear campaign against Daniel. They try to dig up some dirt on him. But we read in Daniel chapter 6, verse 4, that the governors and satraps sought to find some charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find no charge or fault because he was faithful. nor was there any error or fault found in him. So they get into Daniel's closet and try to get some skeletons out, but the closet's empty. They can't find anything. Because Daniel's goal in life was to be faithful, but he put systems in place to help him achieve that faithfulness. In every facet of his life, whether it was his work, whether it was his personal life or his social life, Daniel was faithful. His system was to be the same dependable person no matter what it was he was doing. But that wasn't the only thing he did. These corrupt politicians realized now they're going to have to use Daniel's greatest asset, which is his faithfulness. They're going to have to use that against him. They know their only chance in keeping him from power is to use his faithfulness to God against him. So they convince, they butter up King Darius. And they convince King Darius to issue this month-long decree that throughout the Medo-Persian kingdom for 30 days, no one could legally pray to any god or any man except for King Darius for a month. King Darius takes the bait. He suffered into passing this bogus law, and the law is written in such a way that it can't be reversed or revoked. That puts Daniel between a rock and a hard place. Because his faithfulness was to God. He worships and prays to Jehovah God every day. So here's Daniel's response. Look at Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home. And in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees three times that day, and he prayed and gave thanks before his God. Why? Because that was his custom since early days. That was his custom. That was his habit since early days. This wasn't something he just picked up and did for a couple weeks or a month or two. This wasn't a New Year's resolution. This was a system he put in place for his life that would help him achieve the goal of faithfulness. Prayed three times every day, window open facing Jerusalem. He had been doing that for years, since his early days. That was the system that was in his life when it was okay to do that, and that was the system that was going on in his life when it was illegal and punishable by death to do that. If you want your faith to grow and be more Christ-like, you have to put systems in place to help you reach that goal. You have to change the systems in your life now and replace them with new ones. And my hope is that this series will help us to establish some of those new systems for you. If we fix what we do, how we live, the habits in our lives, the outcomes and the goals will take care of themselves. We have to be very practical about building these spiritual disciplines into our lives now. Now, four of them we're going to look at for the remainder of the month of January, and they are in this order. We're going to look at the habit of study, the habit of prayer, the habit of fasting, and the habit of confession. If we put this system into place for our lives, our goal of being like Christ will be reached. We have to understand the how in order to achieve the what. Here's a second reason we struggle to develop and maintain good habits, and it's that we don't see progress fast enough. We don't see progress fast enough. 92% of New Year's resolutions by Valentine's Day, according to the stats I read this week, are gone. 92% of New Year's resolutions are gone by Valentine's Day. A lot of that happens because we don't see results fast enough. We are not a very patient people. We want to accomplish hard things as easy as we can, which is kind of stupid if you really think about it. We want what we want, and we want it right now. And so a person wants to lose weight, for example. So they exercise maybe 5 days a week and cut back on calories, and after 3 weeks you've lost 3 or 4 pounds. And you're discouraged when you say it doesn't work. You want to grow in your faith, and so you read the Bible every day for a couple of weeks, but then you yell at your kids on the way to church. And you say, this doesn't work at all. When we don't see the progress we want in the amount of time time that we want it, we get discouraged and we give up. We study more, we pray more, but we don't see any kind of a difference. And so we wrongly conclude that small God-honoring decisions don't make that much of a difference. That's a big mistake that you make. That's a big mistake that we make when we think that small God-honoring decisions don't matter. Because think about it in the opposite way. Take the flip side of that and look at not so good, bad habits. So let's say you go and you play golf for three days this next week, till the weather's good. You go play golf for 3 days, your wife's not happy, but she doesn't leave you. So you don't think it's that bad of a decision. You skip church one Sunday, and your whole world doesn't fall apart. That's some good things happen. So you wrongly conclude that that small decision doesn't matter much. You eat a third box of chocolates, and nothing really changes by the next day. So you wrongly conclude that small, not as good decisions don't have that much of an impact. But that's how you get a submarine for a belly. What we have to understand is that our life is the sum total of the small decisions that we make. And most of those decisions are going to be small, everyday decisions, but they add up over time. So you see, when somebody wrecks their life, it's not because they've made one terrible decision at once, usually. What tends to happen is a person wrecks their life, it's death by a thousand cuts. A little compromise here, cut a corner there. Fudge a little bit here, lie a little bit there. Bend the rules a little bit here, step a toe over the line there. Then one day you wake up and you wonder, how did I get where I am? How did I screw my life up so much? You didn't do it all at once. One little bad decision followed by another little bad decision followed by another little bad decision. The little decisions add up and they get you to the point where you are. And then you see this person that seems to have everything together spiritually. And you wonder, how did they do that? Well, first of all, they began by realizing that they don't have it together spiritually. But then they made this everyday, seemingly small decisions. Carve out a half hour in a 24-hour period to read God's Word. And before they go to bed, they hit their knees and they spend time in prayer. And it's not the first time they prayed that day. They took a Saturday out of the month and they said, I'm going to fast from eating today because I really want to deepen in my faith. And they did these little things with such repetition for days and for months and to years. And that's why they seem to have it together spiritually. Because successful people do consistently what most people do occasionally. Your decisions are not being wasted, no matter how small they seem to be. They are being stored up. You may not see it. You may not feel it. But developing these four spiritual disciplines that we're going to talk about in this series, making these small, everyday decisions, will make a huge difference for you over the long haul. There is three verses in the book of Proverbs that really, I think, drive this point home. Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer or ruler, yet it stores its provision in summer and gathers its food at harvest. Now, this is specifically addressing the issues of work and money in Proverbs. But this can really apply to anything, I think. Solomon says the ant goes out on its own during the summer. Nobody's telling him to do this. He just goes out and does it. And during the summer, every day, he goes out and he stores up his provisions. So during the summer, he does this. Summer lasts how long? 3 months, 4 months, something like that? So let's pretend that the ant starts on Memorial Day. Everybody's having a picnic. The ant says, great day to start storing up. He goes and grabs some crumbs from the picnic, brings it back to the ant hill. And he does that again on June the 1st. And he does that again on June the 12th. And he does that again on June the 15th. And he's got a little bit stored up. He doesn't have much. But then he goes out and gets more crumbs on June the 19th. And he does the same thing on June the 28th. Then on 4th of July weekend, he hits the jackpot. It's another picnic. And so he goes, and everybody's sitting on fireworks and eating barbecue, and he grabs some more crumbs. He does that again on July 15th, July 25th, August 1st, August 22nd, August 29th, last day of August, Labor Day weekend. He's gone out every single day of the summer, and he's grabbed a little bit of crumbs. Now, what does he got in his storehouse by the time October rolls around? He's got cabinets full of food. Then the weather changes. It's colder. Food's harder to find. That Ann ain't worried. Why? Because he made several everyday small decisions over a long period of time, and now he's seeing the results. After all that work and the long 95-degree days of working and collecting food and going out and dragging back the anthill, going out, dragging back the anthill, going out, dragging back the anthill, going out, dragging back to the anthill. Now, in January, he's sitting on his couch watching Netflix, and he's got an all-you-can-eat buffet in his pantry because he made some very wise, small decisions for a long period of time. Successful people do consistently what other people only do occasionally. And when you feel like you're not seeing progress, go to the ant. Consider its ways. That ant knows that small decisions add up. Paul put it this way in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. He said, let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Don't get tired of doing small things. Don't get tired, Paul says, of doing what is good. Don't get tired. Don't get tired of doing what is good. Don't get tired of spending less money than you make. Don't get tired of counting calories. Don't get tired of getting up 30 minutes earlier every day to spend time with God and His Word. Don't get tired of coming to God every day and coming clean with your struggles and your sins. Don't get tired of taking periodic moments off from eating, so that you can replace food time with God time. Don't get tired of doing what is good. Don't get tired of doing small things, because they lead to big changes. You will reap a harvest if you do not give. Listen, folks, there is no such thing as an overnight success. No such thing. We see that in people sometimes, but we have no idea of the sacrifices that they have made in the ride. We have no idea the faithfulness and the consistency. We have no idea how many times they've tripped, how many times they've stumbled, how many times they've fallen, how many times they've failed, but they got back up again. We have no idea how many times they went to their room, they opened the door, and they prayed. The things we don't see, going out, collecting crumbs, bringing them back. The things we don't see are the things that make that person successful. Small little habits build up day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, decade after decade, one small decision at a time, doing consistently what other people do occasionally. One other reason we struggle before we close, one reason we struggle to maintain good habits, is we just don't recognize the war going on within us. We do not recognize the war going on within us. It's back to what Paul said in Romans 7. The good that I don't want to do is what I do, and the evil that I don't want to do is what I find myself doing. Paul started that entire section by saying, there's nothing good that lives in me, in my, what he calls, sinful nature. We all have this sin nature within us where if we are left alone, we are going to gravitate toward bad habits instead of good ones. Our default setting, so to speak, is to go away from what is good. Paul says it's my sinful nature. He explains it later, starting in verse 21. He said, I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil's right there with me. He said, in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But he says, there's this other law at work inside my body, waging war against the law of my mind, makes me a prisoner of the law of sin. It's at work within my members. We have to recognize that without the power of God within us, we cannot win the war that's going on for our souls. We have no chance. Without the Holy Spirit to guide us and to fill us and to lead us, we cannot win this war against our sin nature, and we're never going to grow. That's why Scripture says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That's why we need Jesus and the grace that only he offers. That's why we need to be born again in the waters of baptism, so that our sins will be removed as far as the east is from the west, and that God will deposit within us himself in the form of his Holy Spirit, so that we can live not a self-help life, but a Spirit-led life, where we become creatures of habit for the good, servants of Christ, who grow to become more and more like our Savior with each passing day. Let's pray. We thank you, Father, for another day of life that you have given us, and for this opportunity to be challenged by your word, and how we see faithful people throughout Scripture doing the little things every day, developing these systems in their lives to help them reach the goal of becoming faithful and honoring to you. Father, we also see those people stumble. With the exception of Jesus, we see these people stumble back. But Father, the faithful ones kept going. And through the power of your Holy Spirit, through the guidance that you provide, they became spiritual giants that we still remember and honor and study today. But Father, help us to remember that there's really only truly one spiritual giant, and that is your Son. And we are nothing without him, without his grace. We are nothing without the Holy Spirit living within us. We are nothing without leaning on you, our Father, to help us get through some of the difficulties of life. And so, Lord, if there's somebody here today that has never surrendered themselves to Jesus, they've never been born again and received the grace that only he provides, I pray that they would accept him now as we sing this song of invitation. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our song of invitation.
Without him, I could do nothing.
Next Sunday, we're going to be starting the four different habits. habits that we're looking to develop. Next Sunday is going to be the habit of study. What I would challenge you to do, I got this idea for this series from a church in Texas, Hill something in Amarillo, Texas. But if you, some of you, do you have the YouVersion Bible app? Raise your hand. I would strongly recommend those of you who do not have this app to download the YouVersion app, and if you search for Creatures of Habit, you will find 4 7-day devotionals that will cover each of the four spiritual disciplines we're going to study in this series. This week is habits, or this week is the study, next week is prayer, third week is fasting, fourth week is confession. But you will find a 7-day devotional called study, a 7-day devotional called prayer, 7-day devotional called confession, 7-day devotional called fasting. But you can go there, you can start, they've got these different study plans that you can do on this app. And I would strongly recommend you to do that and start those devotions tomorrow. That way we can kind of study all of this together over the next 28 days. If you don't have the app and you don't have a smartphone or you're not really familiar with a smartphone, you can also get this just on your desktop computer. I'm going to put a link to the site where you can get that. I'm going to put a link on our Facebook page today so that you can go there and go through it there. For those of you who don't do computers, who don't do phones, I have printed out a dozen copies of this week's 7-day devotional, which is the habit of study. There's a dozen of those available out there at the communion table when you come into the foyer. If you want to pick one of those up on your way out, remember there's only a dozen. Most of you just need to do this on your phone or on your computer. But if you don't do either, feel free to grab one of those. And each day you have a devotional that will prepare you for next week's message on study. I very much encourage you to take part in that as we go through this series together.